present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that never fails to cut the custard. You join us at the Theatre Royal in Windsor, a town famously associated with our own royal family. It was in 1917 that the House of Saxe, Coburg, Gotha took their new name from the place where they all spent most of their time. So, by the same tradition, when Sarah Ferguson married Prince Andrew, she naturally assumed the title Duchess of Airport. Windsor Castle receives thousands of visitors each year who marvel at the recently completed restoration work undertaken painstakingly by a team of experts who took several months to work out the Latin for in case of fire, break stained glass here. For the finest view, the famous Round Tower is best approached through Henry VIII's gateway, skirting by Queen Mary's budgeons and popping into James II's Tesco Metro. But Windsor has more to offer than just obviously popular attractions. Indeed, there are today several often ignored sights, completely unspoilt by endless queues of eager faces. Let me point out four of them. On my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor. And please also welcome the lovely lady who never misses a good score, the delightful Samantha. Okay, we start with a game called Undelivered Mail from History. This should prove most popular, although there's little hope of its becoming as popular as the one called Undelivered Mail from Reader's Digest. I'd like you please, teams, to suggest the contents of letters that might have changed the course of history had the Postal Service not failed that day. Barry, will you start, please?
Undelivered to Edward VIII. Don't abdicate, she's a man!
Tim?
Dear Lord Irvine, there's bargains galore this Easter at B&Q.
Yours, Tony.
Jeremy?
Dear King Harold, your new contact lenses are ready for collection.
And Graham.
This is one from Emperor Hirohito to the Joint Chiefs of the Imperial Staff. Correction to previous letter, should have read, I want to take out Pearl Bailey.
Dear Dad, everything going pear-shaped, suspect Judas, back Thursday, love Jesus.
Dear St. Paul, will you stop writing to us?
Dear Nelson, see you in my cabin during the battle. Lots of love, Captain Jeremy Hardy.
One from the Department of the Environment. Dear Noah, the emission of methane gas from your enormous menagerie could have catastrophic effects on the climate.
Any more?
To Mozart, dear Am, saw Salieri buying rat poison, keep an eye out. Always finish on an anti-climax.
Okay, then.
I found one here. For...
It's time now for a game called One Song to the Tune of Another, which, despite the title, isn't too difficult when explained logically. In one composition, there are two elements, A, the tune, and B, the words. Taking a second composition, let's call the tune T, and for ease of working, the words Q. Selecting two songs at random, song S and song P, we take B away from S, leaving just A, the tune. And from song P, we subtract T, leaving the words, Q. With everything now split into its simplest form, we can either recombine T with B to form a new S, or A with Q to make a revised P. Well, I see the team's faces light up with the realisation now that they have a choice. Go with the TSB, or draw in AQ for another P. Either way, one song is combined with the tune of another. But one combination, I'm afraid, which we have no choice about, is that of Colin Sell with a piano. Barry, we'll start with you. Will you please sing the words of I Enjoy Being a Girl to the tune of London Pride?
I'm a girl, and by me that's only great. I am proud that my silhouette is curvy, that I walk with a sweet and girlish gait, with my hips kind of swivelly and swervy. I adore being dressed in something frilly when my date comes to get me at my place. Out I go with my Joe or John or Billy, like a filly who is ready for the race. When I have a brand new hairdo with my eyelashes all in curl, I float as the clouds on air do. I enjoy being a girl.
Okay, Jeremy, will you please sing the words of Every Breath You Take to the tune of Knees Up Mother Brach?
Every breath you take and every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you every single day, every word you say, every game you play, every night you stay, I'll be watching you. Oh God, you see that you belong to me, my poor heart aches at every step you take.
Good gracious. It's now you, Graham. Will you please sing the words of Leader of the Pack to the tune of the Habanera from Bizet's Carmen?
Candy store, he turned around and smiled at me. You get the picture? Yes, we see. That's when I fell for the leader of the pack. My folks were always putting me down. They said he came from the wrong side of town. They told me he was bad. I know he was sad. That's why I fell for the leader of the pack. One day my dad said, find someone new. I had to tell my Jimmy we are through. He stood there and asked me why, but all that I could do was a cry.
And finally, Tim, will you please sing the words of Come Into the Garden, Maud, to the tune of the Can Can?
Come into the garden, Maud, for the blackbird night is flown. Come into the garden, Maud, I am here at the gate alone. I'm here at the gate alone, queen of the rosebud, garden of girls, come hither. The dances are done in gloss of satin and glimmer of pearls. Queen Lily ran rose in white thrown out, little head running over with curls to the flowers, stay there, summer. Come into the garden, Maud, for the blackbird night is flown. Oh, come into the garden, Maud, she is coming, my own, my sweet, where it ever so airy I tread, my heart would hear her. The earth he begged, oh, come into the garden, Maud, for the black man is burned. Come into the garden, I'm here at the gate alone. I'm here at the gate alone, queen of the rosebud, come up, come here, the earth is burned. He was a doctor, aye!
Okay, the next round is called Straight Face. It's specially named in tribute to the wonderful audience we have here in the theatre. The object of this round is for our teams to take it in turns to come up with certain words on a given subject which will produce absolutely no laughter. The slightest titter, and that person is out. And that's not just out of the game, it's out of the theatre. Interestingly, the world record for this game is held by our own Barry Cryer, who once came up with 3,438 consecutive words without evoking a single laugh in response. In fact, the feat is still spoken about by the West Ruislip branch of the British Euthanasia Society. For whom he was providing the after-dinner speech. Okay, teams, I'd like you to exchange your unfunny words, please, on the subject of the countryside. Jeremy, will you start, please?
Silage.
Hound.
Hunt.
Mulch.
Style.
Blood.
Rape.
Subsidy.
Inbreeding.
Watch it.
Aldridge.
Newts.
Laugh there.
Oh.
What? Somewhere in Slough?
Definitely. My decision is final. You're out, Tim. Okay, carry on, whoever's next.
Bullock.
Set aside.
Dung.
Heifer.
Cousins.
Yeah, sorry, Jeremy.
Close.
It's between you, Barry, and Graham.
Slurry.
Fringe.
Well, we must move on. The next round is based on Monopoly. Our version was specially adapted from the popular board game by way of homage to its brilliant creator. Incidentally, homage is a foreign word of interesting derivation and can be used in various forms as petty homage, safe homage, and of course homaging a building society with a sawn-off shotgun. Okay, team, Samantha has laid out the board for you exactly as we left the game last time. Tim, will you start, please?
Community chest. Good news, you've won second prize in a beauty contest. Bad news, second to Robin Cook.
Graham?
Oh, the master.
Luck be a lady tonight. Whoa, two the hard way. I've landed on power gen. Has anyone got that?
No. I've got Mr. Bun.
No, I'll buy power gen then.
Buy power gen.
Yeah. There we go.
Oh, right. Oh, community chest. You are trapped in a lift with Robin Williams. Go straight to therapy. So be it.
Jeremy.
Good one.
Old Victoria Station, pay £2,000 to a prostitute.
One of the cheaper ones.
Go back to the old Kent Road where you belong, you cockney tosser.
Here we go. 17. Chance. Income tax paid 20p. Blimey, that's gone up.
It's now time to play a game called Cheddar Gorge. In this round, I'll be asking the teams to construct a sentence by each of them uttering a single word at a time. The object is not to complete the sentence. I have the horn as usual, and when I... And when I consider a sentence has been completed, teams, you'll hear this. Okay, teams, I'd like your sentence to take the form of a letter to the head of Radio 4. Extra points will be awarded for the inclusion of bonus words. Barry, yours is enormous. Jeremy, yours is inspired. Graham, yours is breathtaking.
Okay.
And Tim, yours is outstanding.
On a cold day, too.
Okay, Graham, will you start, please?
Why?
Oh.
Why?
Why? Oh.
Why?
Oh. Why is
the
schedule
so
outstanding
and
inspired?
Yeah, that completed a sentence. God knows what happens now. Carry on, Graham.
Many
of
the
listeners thought you were out.
Oh,
wait a minute, doesn't say
he said he was out.
That's the last game. He doesn't go out.
I'm sorry, Jeremy.
No.
I'm not out. I'm still coming to terms with things at the moment.
Well, many of the listeners are
hoping
to
engage
you
in
some
productive
debate
on
enormous
matters.
Let's have one more round of that. Go on, Graham.
I'm starting again.
Right. No, you're not, Tim.
Why?
Oh.
Why?
Oh.
Spells.
Something
beginning
with
the
letter
Y. Right.
Our next round is called New Versions. It's inspired by the current Radio 4 policy of rejigging old shows and putting them in different slots. The 1 o'clock news is now followed by Mastermind. Round Britain Quiz can't be followed by anyone. And Nicholas Parsons in the psychiatrist's chair is followed by prayer for the day. The team's task is to act out new versions of literary classics. Barry and Graham, I'd like you to start, please, by giving us your interpretation of Moby Dick in the style of Noel Coward.
Someday I'll find you. Watch out behind you. I've got a great big...
Captain Ahab. I am Mr. Worthington.
You must be my first mate.
I find that very hard to believe. Nevertheless, call me Ishmael.
What a pretty name.
Thank you.
Are you afraid of Moby Dick?
Not at all. I always take precautions.
There she blows, a vast behind.
Who was that?
I thought he was with you.
There's not a moment to lose. Man the boat, lower the sail, empty the ashtrays.
Quick, pass me that long pointed thing and join me in a foxtrot.
Gladly, but why?
It only harpoons when I dance with you. you are doing?
Good shutter.
Uncanny.
Now I shall haul him onto the landing stage and slice him into tiny little pieces.
No, no, I beg you. Don't put your slaughter on the stage, Mr. Don't put your slaughter on the stage. In the midday sun.
Your turn now, Tim and Jeremy. Let's hear your new version of Macbeth in the style of MasterChef.
Well, tonight we have three contestants. Which one are you?
No, I'm witch too. Oh, see, I see what you mean. Who are you, may ask?
I'm Thane of Cawdor and Bane of Pronunciation.
Be making braised tongue of dog with a coolie of eye of newt. Would you like a... Would you like a wee taste?
Now, do I detect nose of Turk and tartar's lips?
Well, my mother slept about a bit, so it's possible.
Now, what about dessert?
Well, I was thinking of laying on a Macduff.
I'm so glad that Spotted Dick is out of fashion. Out, damn Spotted Dick, out, I say. Is this a dagger I see before me?
Oh, I thought you were just pleased to see me.
Next week on Master McChef, a Danish theme, we'll be making omelette prince of dishes.
Oh, I see what you mean, that's awful good.
Time now for Censored Song, where the team sings songs while taking care to remove any words liable to offend the more sensitive ear. Too much smut has polluted the airwaves of late, and I'm given to understand that even this programme has made inadvertent transgressions. Were it not for a particularly keen-eared listener, we'd never have known there were filthy meanings to such expressions as melons, bristles, knockers, or huge thripney bits. Our thanks go to the Bishop of Norwich for taking the trouble. The songs will be accompanied on the piano by Colin Sell. Actually, we're all very excited for Colin, as he's been invited to play at a U2 gig. What great reunion dances those German submarine crews. Okay, we'll start with you, Tim and Jeremy. Will you please provide a censored version of Leaning on a Lamppost?
Hey. I'm leaning on a lamppost at the corner of the street in case a certain little lady comes through. Oh, my. I hope the little lady comes by.
Don't if she'll get...
She doesn't always get...
But anyway, I know that she'll try.
Me. Oh, my. I hope that little comes.
There's no other girl I could for.
This one I'd break any for.
I won't have to ask.
She'd never be flat.
She's not a girl like that.
Absolutely wonderful and marvellous and beautiful, and anyone can understand why.
I'm sitting on a lamppost at the corner of the street in case a certain little lady.
Okay, Barry and Graham, would you please provide your censored version of Whistle a Happy Tune?
Whenever I feel afraid, I hold my erect and whistle a happy tune so no one will suspect I'm a... The result of this deception is very plain to tell, for when I... The people I myself as well. When in my shoes I strike a careless pose, happy tune, so no one ever knows I'm a...
Well, we're rapidly approaching the end of the show, but there's just time to fit in a round of Hairdressers Film Club. Senior stylist Samantha has been called back to the salon, where there's a regular client waiting to have his length adjusted before she... before she finishes him off with an expert blow. So... so while she does that, I'd like the teams to suggest titles of films that might suit an audience of hairdressers, barbers and the like. Barry, will you start, please?
Die Hard. With the artist formerly known as Rince.
Something for the Lost Weekend.
Hair, the director's cut.
The one you've been waiting for. Bring me the head and shoulders of our global Garcia. They died with their roots done.
Mr. Smith goes to Wash and Go.
And of course, there's all those films by Lassie's only real Hollywood canine rival. Rinse, Tince, Tinge.
Terms of endearment.
Quiff Vardis.
Indiana Jones and the Last Pomade. Starring Sean Completely and Hair Extension Ford.
Top Bun.
And from Disney, Peter Pan Teen Pro V Plus.
Well, as the scales of time are confronted by the Vanessa Feltz of eternity, and the cubicle of destiny is selected by the George Michael of fate, I notice it's the end of the show, so from Samantha, the teams, myself, and the fine people of Windsor, it's goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the panel game where the teams come in like a lion and go out like a light. You find us once again in Windsor, the town which gave its name to a type of chair, a knot, and most famously, a soup. Although this was before the Royal Barrow changed its name from Campbell's Cream of Mushroom Montana. But a stone's throw across the river is Eton with its world-renowned school. According to my guide notes, Eton's most famous former pupils include the Duke of Wellington, William Gladstone, George Orwell, and Humphrey Littleton, the jazz musician and panel game host. They don't say what those other three are famous for. Let's meet the teams. The same four comedians were here at the Theatre Royal last week when they produced a performance that's impossible to forget. I've been to hypnosis, but it didn't work. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And facing them on my right, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor. And also joining us once again is our delightful scorer, Samantha. Now, as we all know, Britain and Europe are moving inexorably closer together. But we couldn't think of a game based on plate tectonics. So instead, teams, we'll play a round called Euro TV and Radio Guide, in which I'd like you please to suggest continental versions of some of our own TV and radio programmes. Barry, will you start, please?
The Cologne Ranger. And his horse vessel.
Jeremy.
The Big Bratwurst.
Graham.
Yes, in France they've got a game show where teams identify pieces of meat. It's called Call My Boeuf.
Israel, they think it's Passover.
Another one from France. They've decided to combine World Cup special and casualty.
And Switzerland has combined World at War with the money programme.
In Ireland, the Archers is now on 8 nights a week.
A popular Italian sitcom called Men Behaving Normally.
In France, they have one man and his frog.
Germany, V asks the questions time.
Are you being served?
France, they have can cook, will cook.
Spain has the world at Juan.
And Russia has shooting Tsars.
Super Maastricht sweep. ERM.
We have an amusing round now. Called Pick Up Song, featuring a selection of fine old recordings drawn from the archive. Hip-hop, jive-talking, disco bunny DJ Samantha rolled her sleeves up and had a good rummage downstairs for the teams this afternoon. She's pulled out some dusty old 7 inches.
Blimey.
That could all be made big again, given sympathetic handling. She's poised over the turntable now, ready to spin some discs as each singer in turn joins in. At my signal, Samantha will turn the volume down to nothing. If when the music returns, teams, you're within a goblin's mouth organ of the original. I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. What do prizes mean?
Prize!
Never works that, does it? This week's prize will give instant peace of mind to any lover of unusual animals who's worried that their pet might go astray. It's this self-addressed antelope. Okay, we've tried two duets this week. The first one's for you, Tim and Jeremy. Would you please accompany the band Aqua with their smash hit song, Barbie Girl?
Hiya, Barbie.
Hi, Ken.
You want to go for a ride?
Sure, Ken.
Jump in.
I'm a Barbie girl in a Barbie world. Life in plastic, it's fantastic. You can press my hand. Dress me everywhere. Imagination, life is your creation.
Come on, Barbie, let's go, Barbie.
Barbie girl in a Barbie world. Life in plastic, it's fantastic. You can press my hand, undress me everywhere. Imagination, life is your creation. I'm a blonde single girl in a fantasy world. Dress me up, make it bright, I'm your dolly.
You're my doll, rock and roll. Feel the drummer and bass. Kiss me here, touch me there, hanky panky.
You can touch, you can play. If you say, I'm always yours. I'm a Barbie. In the Barbie world, life in plastic is fantastic.
Your turn now, Barry and Graham, and your song is The Delightful Summer Nights from Greece. Graham, I'd be pleased if you would essay the role of John Travolta and stretching imagination to breaking point. Barry, would you take the part of Olivia Newton-John?
Summer loving
happened so fast.
Uncanny.
Met a girl crazy for me.
Met a boy cute as can be.
Summer days drifting away, but oh, those summer nights. Well, tell me more. Did you get very far?
Tell me more. Like, does he have a car?
She swam by me, she got a cramp.
He ran by me, got my suit damp.
Saved her life, she nearly drowned.
He showed off, splashing around.
Summer sun, something's begun, but oh, the summer nights.
And for a derisory fee, I have to sit in the middle listening to that. Okay, our next game takes as its subject the nursery rhyme, a children's entertainment that sadly fell from popularity with the advent of the mechanical toy. A prime example was Lego, which became so successful that it is now here in Windsor in entire Lego land. For a small fee, parents can bring their children to enjoy a large area of toy buildings constructed out of plastic bricks. Alternatively, they can save their money and take the kids to Milton Keynes for the day. In an attempt to revive the nursery rhyme teams, I'd like you please to update some traditional verses to give them contemporary relevance. Start off, Barry, please.
This little piggy went to market. This little piggy stayed at home. This little piggy had roast beef. And now he thinks he's a duck.
Okay, Jeremy.
Hush-a-bye, baby, on the treetop. When the wind blows, the cradle will rock. When the bough breaks, the cradle will fall. This is a new birthing technique from France.
Graham.
1, 2, buckle my shoe. 3, 4, knock at the door. 5, 6, pick up sticks. 7, 8, lay them straight. 9, 10, bingo!
Mary had a little lamb. Its fleece was white as snow. A Frenchman put a match to it, and now it's all aglow.
Ride a cock horse to Banbury Cross to see a fine lady on a white horse. With rings on her navel and studs on her lip, who'd have thought nipple rings would ever be hip?
Pussycat, pussycat, where have you been? I've been up to London to visit the Queen. Pussycat, pussycat, what did you there? I told her Geoffrey Archer must never be mayor.
Georgie Porgie pudding and pie went into the gents, now we all know why.
Little Miss Muffet sat on a tuffet, eating her curds and whey. There came a big spider and sat down beside her. At least he said he was a spider.
Educationally challenged Simon met a pie person. Going to the fair, said educationally challenged Simon to the pie person, BSE, beware.
Graham?
Old King Cole was a merry old soul, and a merry old soul was he. He called for his pipe and he called for his bowl and had a colonic irrigation.
Old Mother Hubbard went to the cupboard to get her poor dog a bone, but when she got there, the cupboard was bare because she'd bought too many lottery tickets.
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she didn't know what to do. Obviously.
Little Boy Blue, come blow your horn. You must be very supple.
One more, Barry.
Hey, diddle diddle, the cat and the fiddle. The cow jumped over the moon. Little dog laughed to see such sport and scored some more stuff on a spoon.
Right. It's time now to play the game called Mornington Crescent. But first of all, I noticed from the pile in our listener reaction in tray, we've received almost two letters this week, including this. Including this one from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. Mrs. Trellis admits to becoming a little confused by the recent Radio 4 programme changes. Dear Shula, she writes. How awful they should both move the Moral Maze and change its name. You can imagine my horror and dismay when I tuned in specially and found I hadn't missed it yet. Yours faithfully, Mrs. Trellis. OK, on with the game, teams. And since we're close to my alma mater, Eton College, an institution that I was disturbed to read the other day was second only to Formula One for its dependence on fags, this week's contest will be played according to old Etonian rules. So, teams, all suburban routes are out of bounds. And if any two individuals become boxed, it's the senior player who's granted right of way. Also, if a player makes a move that his fellows, or in this case the audience, see fit to applaud, then he's officially in pop and is entitled to wear a silly floral waistcoat and to make his next move out of turn. All very sensible. Tim, will you start, please?
Paddington Green.
King's Road.
Collier's Wood.
Have you done this before?
Once. Well, I was sick after.
You're botched, all right.
I thought you'd already got the floral waistcoat.
Graham.
Yeah, right. No, I'm not boxed.
You're not boxed
no, I'm
already.
I'm sure I'm not. No, it can't be. Because I've got Fairlight Avenue.
Ah, yeah.
Hatton Cross.
Dodgy. How did you know my pet name? Queensgate.
Walthamstow Central?
Not boxed. No, not boxed. No.
Princess Terrace, I can go out of order,
yes,
senior.
You can. Yep.
No, you can't because it's not boxed.
No, he was, though.
That's he was, though.
I think it was, wasn't it suburban?
It's a question of whether it is now.
Well, he's in pop now.
I could go out of order then.
Yeah.
Adjudication, please, Humph.
What does that mean? Now, Tim's right. Carry on.
Clapham Common.
Hounslow West.
Wandsworth High Street.
No, wait a minute. No, Hounslow West, surely. That's not.
Is that...
That's boxing.
Is that... That's not...
No, that's something when people belt the living daylights out of it.
Now, Hounslow East would have been boxing, but West's okay.
Oh, yeah. Right. Playing those rules, are we?
Fairlop.
Oh, not again.
I can only go Tottenham Court Road.
It's not a bad thing to do, actually.
Walk right, oh, in. Walks right into it.
Yeah. That'll be sick again. Yeah.
Walking right into it. Highgate.
Hounslow East.
Mornington Crescent.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Friday. Lamb to the slaughter.
Jolly good. Congratulations. It's time to lighten the mood a little. I've recently been informed that much of what passes for popular entertainment these days merely trades on an insatiable interest in disasters heaped upon humanity. Titanic, the Charge of the Light Brigade, the Hindenburg disaster, the Deirdre Barlow trial, the new Radio 4 schedule, have all been foisted upon the public, and it's been suggested that in this climate of unrelenting doom, it might be an idea for the team to tell a few amusing jokes. I shall provide each player with a suitable subject. The first will start, but when I do this, the next should take over, but cleverly twisting the joke to suit his allocated subject, and so on. The winner will be the first to reach his punchline, which will be signalled by unbridled mirth from our theatre audience, or the canned laughter track, whichever comes first. Barry, your subject is anteaters. Graham, burglars. Tim, a meat pie, and Jeremy, Quasimodo. Tim, will you start, please?
Man went into a pub and he went to the barman and he said, "What's that sign?" And there was a sign that said, "A pint, a pie, a friend."
And barman said, "Excuse me, sir, these two anteaters were first, if you wouldn't mind waiting." They ordered 2 pints of lager and 2 packets of pork scratchings, which they took over to a table in the corner where they sat. Trying to ignore a man with a large klaxon horn in the other corner of the pub.
And he said, "That's not a horn, that's my hump." This man was Quasimodo, and he was there with his friends Snow White and Tom Thumb. And Snow White said, "Do you know, I've got a magic mirror in my handbag, and it talks."
"What was that noise?" said Quasimodo. There was a noise in the back room, because unbeknownst to them, 3 burglars who had robbed a bank were making their escape, chased by the police, and they'd broken into the back of this pub. There was an Englishman, an Irishman, and a Scotsman.
And at this moment, the anteater said, "Drinks on me, everyone, including the burglars. I see this sign, a pint of pine."
And they were drinking their pints of lager, as you remember, and eating their pork scratchings. And
was.
The barman came over to them. So
he said, "Those pork scratchings are bits of Quasimodo's face. I do apologise." But Snow White tried to cheer Quasimodo up because he was embarrassed about his physical state, and she showed him this magic mirror. And she said, "Now, here's the thing, I can talk to this mirror." And she said, "Mirror, mirror, out of my handbag, who is the best?"
"Nobody move,"
said a voice. Said the anteater. "Can I have a word with you, Snow White?"
The barman was still worried about the 2 anteaters, and he came back to the table yet again and said, "Are those pork scratchings all right? I can replace them or you can have your money back." And they said, "No, these pork scratchings are fine." So he went away. And they carried on with the...
with no regard at all for what was happening with Snow White and this mirror. "Mirror, mirror, out of my handbag," she said, "who is the fairest of them all?" "Why, you, Snow White," said the mirror, talking in a loud mirror-like accent. And she said, "Have a go at this, Tom Thumb." And he said, "Mirror, mirror, out of Snow White's handbag, who is the shortest of them all?" And he said, "Why, you, Tom Thumb." And then they said to Quasimodo, "Go on, Quasimodo, have a go with the mirror." And he said, "No, I don't like it, so I'm not really big on mirrors." And they said, "I'll tell you what, take it over in the corner. We won't listen, and you can come and tell us what the mirror said." So he goes over and he talks to the mirror. And he comes back a couple of moments later and he says, "Who the flip's Anne Widdecombe?"
Time for a musical round in which the teams will take it in turns to sing various lines in order to make up the verses of a madrigal. The madrigal is a form of music chiefly popular in the 16th century and fondly remembered by several of our panellists. Musical accompaniment will be provided by our resident pianist Colin Sell, whose mother tells me he mastered the scales at the age of 6. And by 7, he could flush the bathroom toilet all by himself. Okay, I'll provide you with the subject teams, which I'd like you to continue in madrigal form, taking one line each until you hear this noise. The subject is President Clinton. Jeremy, will you start, please?
As I walked out one May morning, all in the White House grounds,
from out the Oval Office, I heard such curious sounds.
I peeped in through the window
and saw Bill standing on a bucket.
I said, "What are you doing?"
He said, "I'm trying to see Nantucket."
The president then asked me, "Have you seen my White House staff?"
I misconstrued his meaning and I gave a nervous laugh.
Then up there popped a fine young lass.
He said, "This is my lodger." I said, "What is that in her mouth?" He said, "A jammy dodger."
Well, it's very nearly the end of the programme, but there's just time to announce some late arrivals at the Hoteliers' Ball. Before we start, Samantha has to pop off to continue her evening job trying out country house hotel rooms for a travel guidebook. She tells me she enjoys a different local inn every night. Meanwhile, I'd like the teams to please announce the names of their late arrivals at a ball for hotel owners and the like. Tim, will you start, please?
Will you please welcome Mr. and Mrs. John Smith? Mr. and Mrs. John Smith? Mr. and Mrs. John Smith? Mr. Humphrey Littleton and Rita Goodlay? Sorry, Mr. and Mrs. John Smith, the famous trumpeter and composer of Bad Penny Blues, and his lead vocalist.
Mr. and Mrs. Tring for large parties. And their daughter Kay Tring for large parties.
Mr. and Mrs. Barr and their daughter Minnie Barr.
And will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Rouser Press? And their son Corbett Rouser Press.
From Ireland, the Ference Facilities, and their impressive son, the excellent Conference Facility. God bless you, sir.
And from even further afield, the Sultan of Cap, and his flattering son, the complimentary Shah Cap.
Mr. and Mrs. Nkit, and their daughter Zoe Nkit.
All the way from Wales, Mr. and Mrs. for phone calls made after paying the bill. And their son, Owen, for phone calls made after paying the bill.
And will you welcome Mr. and Mrs. Bennett, £17.50 for a continental breakfast. And their son, Gordon Bennett, £17.50 for a continental breakfast.
All the way from Scotland, Mr. and Mrs. Brake. And their son, we can break.
And will you welcome, from Liverpool, Cookwillia, and their son, Jess Cookwillia.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Actuate down the fire escape and assemble in the car park, and their daughter,
evacuate down the forest, assemble in the car park.
And a warm, warm welcome for Mr. and Mrs. Speaking Hammerhell Pew and their daughter, Tracy Speaking Hammerhell Pew.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as the plump, juicy earwig of time burrows into the uncapped toothpaste of destiny, and the hairy spider of fate lurks hungrily under the toilet seat of eternity, I notice it's the end of the show. So from Samantha, the teams, myself, and the good people of Windsor, it's goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garvin, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel gaze. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that never fails to pull something surprising out of the bog. You join us today in the fine city of Leeds, which still has many reminders of the part it played in the Industrial Revolution. Starting at nearby Middleton is the oldest railway in England, with its original line and stock virtually unchanged since 1758. It was recently privatised and renamed the Midland Main Line to Euston Circus. The city has connections with many famous people. Well-loved celebrities include Alan Bennett and Barry Cryer. Wait a minute, there's a bit here I didn't read. Well-loved local celebrities include Alan Bennett and Barry Cryer used to know his milkman. We are guests today of the City Varieties Theatre. This, the undisputed home of old-time music hall, is famous for folk who sport Edwardian costume, and I notice that our team members are dressed in suits of similar vintage. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Paul Merton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And eager to lend a hand when the team's points are on the up. Please welcome our resident scorer, the delightful Samantha. Okay, let's start with round one this week, which appropriately enough is called Famous First Words. Teams, I'd like you please to fill in some historical gaps by suggesting the first words of people either still with us or appearing on the National Lottery big ticket. Barry, will you start, please?
Ian Paisley's first words. And furthermore! As if he'd been saying something earlier.
Paul.
Lloyd Grossman, who could live in a womb like this?
Graham.
Tony Blair. You're right, Mum. Labour leaves you knackered.
Tim.
President Clinton. Nurse, would you mind putting your hand on this? Lord Irving. That wallpaper's got to go.
William Hague, I'm always going to look like this. Colonel Tom Thumb.
Over here!
And Mrs. Thatcher, now we are a baby.
David Frost. So what's it like to be my mother then? You must be very proud.
Winston Churchill. I'm always going to look like this. Robin Cook, this is the best I'll ever look.
Bernie Ecclestone.
Over here!
Charlton Heston, I parted the waters myself.
Okay. Right, it's time now for an old favourite called One Song to the Tune of Another. A game which neatly combines both its title and its rules in one. Using the description of a game as its title still goes on in some countries, particularly in China. Literally translated, the Chinese for snooker is use thin rod to clear table of coloured balls. Skating is translated as catch frostbite while falling off metal shoes. Darts as fat blokes get drunk. And rugby as push face into buttocks of man in front. Which coincidentally is also the title of the new BBC management training manual. Okay, teams, I shall now introduce a series of implausible musical combinations, starting with the first, and most implausible, Colin Sell and a piano. Tim, I'd like you to start by singing the words of the theme to Friends to the tune of Jerusalem.
So no one told you life was gonna be this way. Your job's a joke, you're broke, your love life's DOA. It's like you're always stuck in second gear. When it hasn't been your day, your week, your month, or even your year. But I'll be there for you when the rain starts to fall. I'll be there for you like I've been there before. I'll be there for you, cause you're there for me too. I'll be there for you, cause you're there for me too.
Graham, now, will you please sing the words of Sorry Seems to Be the Hardest Word to the tune of Get Me to the Church on Time.
What have I got to do to make you love me? What have I got to do to make you care? What do I do when lightning strikes me and I wake to find that you're not there? What do I do to make you want me? What have I gotta do to be heard? What do I say when it's all over? Sorry seems to be the hardest word. It's sad, it's so sad, it's a sad, sad situation. And it's getting more absurd, it's sad, it's so sad, why can't we talk it over? Always in, but sorry seems to be the hardest word. What do I do to make you love me? What have I got to do to be heard? Oh, what have I got to do to be heard? Hey!
Paul, now, will you please sing the words of Meet the Gang from It Ain't Half Hot Num to the tune of Scarborough Fair.
Meet the gang, cause the boys are here. The boys to entertain you with music and laughter to help you on your way. Raising the rafters with a hey, hey, hey. The songs and sketches, the jokes old and new, with us about, is that note again? You won't feel blue. So meet the gang, cause the boys are here.
Sing lofty.
Oh,
I'm over here.
The boys to entertain you.
Oh, bravo.
Right, follow that, Barry. Would you please sing the words of My Old Man's a Dustman to the tune of Heartbreak Hotel?
Now here's a little story to tell, it is a must, about an unsung hero that moves away at us. Baby, fortune, baby, others earn a mint. Oh, my old man don't earn much. In fact, he's flipping skin. Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears go-blimey trousers and he lives in a castle pack. He looks at proper Nana, baby, in his great big hobnail boots. Yeah, hobnail boots. He's got such a job to pull him off that he calls them Daisy Roots. Oh, mama. Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears go-blimey trousers and he lives in a council flat. Some folks get tips at Christmas and some of them forget. So when he picks their pins up, he spills some on the stand. Oh yeah.
Well, that got him going.
I knew he wasn't dead.
On with the next round now. As we have Paul Merton with us today, not to play our version of Have I Got News For You would be a criminal waste of his unique talent. Still, never mind. Instead, we have a great new idea to play a radio adaptation which we'll call the News Quiz. We start round one with a cutting which will be read by Samantha. Finish? Oh, there's some more. And for sending that, we have to thank a Mr. S. A Mr. S. Rushdie of Flat B, 15 Maple Court, Swindon. As we've never played this before, teams, we've got a lot of catching up to do. So, Tim, can you guess which story is hidden behind this cryptic clue? Whose creation made him go all weak?
Paul's writing something. What is it? Take your hand off my knee. Oh, sorry.
No, I think it's Nigel Xlax, the anniversary of his birth, who, amazing man, you all know his legendary invention. They still talk of the day he passed a driving test.
I think it probably is that, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, Barry, here's your item. Which gardener turned over a new leaf and said, "Caw"?
This must be Lord Irvine, who's moved on to having his garden done. Trees have got gold leaves. The lawn's been set by a firm called Sodit. And even the grass is imported. It's Colombian grade A.
Paul. Paul, your clue is, who looked good in the rushes before going on to take his tablets?
Oh, but this is Moses. It's Ed Moses, the athlete, isn't it? Well, no, actually, it's Ben Johnson, the rushes, that's him, his speed records. And before going on to take his tablets, well, I mean, that was the pharmaceutical intake, which allowed him to run 100 metres in 0.4 seconds. He jumped off a cliff.
Oh, Lemming Johnson, we call
that. That's it. Lemming Johnson.
Are these all biblical
questions, these. Am I seeing a theme here, Hump?
I'm beginning to suspect that they might be, yes.
Right.
Graham, here's your clue. Whose trouble and strife was taken with a pinch of salt?
This is a rhyming slang question here. Trouble and strife, wife. Pinch of salt, Walt. as in Disney. And I think, in this case, a reference to that lovable little rodent, Robin Cook. His wife, Gaynor, obviously, is taken with him. In fact, the press keep asking, why does the new Mrs. Robin Cook never smile? Clues in the question, I think.
My card says, let's hurry along to our next game. Now, as many of you know, Leeds is one of many provincial destinations to which we've come as part of the BBC's ongoing programme to dispel the myths and stereotypes about regional Britain. Which brings us to our next game. A-op mother. If to whippets in bath. Where's to co? Or to give it its English title, Job Seekers. In this round, one team assumes the role of interviewers, the other applicants for a certain job. The object is for the applicants, while giving the impression of great willingness and enthusiasm, to fail to get the job. We'll start with you, Barry and Graham. I'd like you to be applicants for jobs as air traffic controllers. Tim and Paul, you're the interviewers. Okay, off you go.
What first attracted you to the job?
Which one of you said that? The old eyes, what they were?
Just follow the sound of my voice, I'm sure.
Oh, right. Yeah. You're over there, right? But I think what attracted us was there's a lot of sitting down involved.
Have you had any previous experience of sitting down?
Yes, I have to sit down a lot because I often drop off to sleep. Unexpectedly, and it's a bit of a shock to the system if you're standing when that happens. So I do need a job where I'm seated for most of the day.
Have you had any previous experience in this air traffic control?
I'm sorry, I was miles away.
Do you mind if I pop out for pee for a minute? It's just the old problem, you know. Oh. I can't be more than 2 minutes sitting in the same place.
That's all right. We've got a bucket in the corner.
Yeah. We've put in for a lottery grant to get a commode.
Yes. Will I be able to see it from where I'm sitting?
You'll be able to smell it. Ah.
So when can you start work?
Any time.
Tuesday?
Tuesday? Oh, blimey, sorry, I just had one of my panic attacks. I'm getting mad again.
Well, finally, I mean, are you familiar with the latest radar systems?
Sorry?
Oh. Radar.
Oh, yeah, I never miss an episode. My favourite, MASH. You never watch it, do you?
I don't watch much television because, you know, if I watch a screen for any length of time...
So, we got the job.
Oh, I think you have, definitely, yeah. Ideal.
Right, let's try that the other way around. Tim and Paul, you can be applicants for jobs as vets. Barry and Graham, you're the interviewers this time.
Oh, well, welcome to the surgery.
Thank you
very much.
Yes, a vet. What had attracted you chaps to the job in the first place?
Well, I like working with people.
Have you had any experience with animals?
I was a butcher.
Yes.
And I was a butcher's mate.
Slaughterhouse, 3 or 4 years.
Well, you certainly know your animals.
Well, not for very long. No.
And you're happy to work with all types of animals, I take it, are you?
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely, yes. Yes.
Domestic cats and dogs.
Achoo!
You said it! Oh,
there's definitely a cat in here, isn't it?
Yeah.
Set you off again.
Achoo!
Sorry, he gets every time there's a C-H-U, no, he goes.
Does that spell cat?
Achoo! Oh, it does. He's even allergic to the spelling.
Snakes?
Oh, I don't like snakes myself, actually. No, they bring me out in a rash. Sort of eczema.
Oh, yeah. Horses? But, horses?
No, just eczema, really.
Well, how about farm animals? Cows.
What, those big things with horns?
Yeah.
You've got to be joking.
Well, I'd be no good with cows. I've got very short arms.
Yeah.
Gerbils.
Pardon? Wasn't he Hitler's propaganda minister?
I like gerbils in their place. Yeah. You can never shift them, I find. Have we got the job?
Right, it's time for the next round. Last week, teams, I received a letter from an elderly listener who complained of finding many of the rounds hard to follow and suggested that we played a good old-fashioned game like Scrabble. So impressed was I by the suggestion that I immediately decided in modern BBC parlance to be proactively and non-financially customer responsive, or as we used to put it, rip the idea off without paying for it. So, teams, let's try. You know the rules. Samantha has already given you your allocation of letters, and I've got a large dictionary in front of me should any dispute arise. Barry, we'll start with you. Can you make a word?
I thought I'd got flatulence there for the minute, but... I haven't got the F in flatulence. No.
Can't do anything.
Can't do anything. I'm...
Paul?
Gitzrick.
Gitzrick?
Yeah, but that's just the order the letters are in. I could get another one, probably, if I just... Tegesura.
Ah!
I've got the Bosnian version of the game here.
Graham.
got seven letters here.
That's a good idea. Whoa!
Quinquagesimal.
Tim?
I've got an E, a U, an R, and an O. Spells trouble.
Barry.
I've got... Oh, wait a minute. W-E-T-H-I-R. Worst spell of weather I can remember. Oh, wait a minute. W-A-K-N. Raw Ken. Waken. Oh, there's an S here. It could be a plural. No, it won't. It won't happen. Won't happen. Haven't quite got it.
Thank
God. Just playing with myself here, I don't know. Oh.
Come on, Paul. Hurry along.
Oh, well, I've still got the same letters as I had before, really. Can I change them for something else?
Yep.
All right, I'd like to change them for a small motorbike, please.
I've got X, F, T, Z, Q, J, B. I know it's a proper word because I read it in The Guardian.
I think it's my turn, though.
Yes.
Get down.
I can make Whiteley.
Make him what?
Oh, no, I can't. No. haven't got the sense of timing.
Barry?
Umagulis. African bird.
Is that the bird with the short legs?
That's right. And a huge wingspan. Doesn't like landings. So goes on the roof.
I think Barry's just gone out.
Has he gone out?
Yeah. Yes, I've gone out.
Oh, well, thankful for small mercies. Well, we're rapidly approaching the end of the show, but there's just time left for the Welsh Film Festival. Samantha tells me she's off on a mountaineering course with a couple of chaps she knows who are equipped like whales and enjoy... equipped like whales and enjoy a rarebit. So while she nips out to pack, I'll ask the team to suggest a season of films that might suit the Welsh Film Festival. We'll start with you, Tim.
Cooled Hand, Look You?
Leek Marvin in Paint Your Dragon?
Die Hard? Die Hard 2? I was going to say that, but you groaned at the first one.
An American in Powys. The one you've all been waiting for. Bring me the holly head of Alfredo Garcia.
There's also Bridge Over the River Wye and The Magnificent Seven.
The Clanvar por Kingwith Gogareth can drop as Clantisilio go 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 between.
Oh, it's good to see the old classic, The Good, the Bad, and Clanecly. Tappy Come Home.
Or Breakfast at Taffy Knees.
Mad Max Boyce.
The Eagle Has Landed No.
Look You Back in Bangor.
Hugh Dares Gwyneth.
Nine and a half leaks.
Evans Can Wait.
Shake, Rattle and Rill.
The Outlaw Josie England. I Steadford Zebra.
A Fish Guard Called Rhonda.
And the Tragicomic Romance, Sheepless in Seattle. And its heartwarming sequel, When Harry Met Dolly.
And the third in the sequence, The Sheep That Died of Shame.
And so...
Bob and Carol and Dill and Thomas.
Haverford West was one.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the blue cagouled rambler of time confronts the colorblind bull of destiny, and the dead pigeon of fate decomposes in the water tank of eternity, I notice it's the end of the show. So from Samantha, myself, the teams, and fine people of Leeds, it's goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden and Paul Merton will be given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, where fun and laughter get on like a mouse on fire. You join us for a second week at the City Varieties Theatre in the fine Yorkshire town of Leeds. Founded on textiles, the city had until 1969 one of the world's largest woolen mills. Then someone pulled at a loose thread and the whole building... Yeah, the whole building unravelled. No visit here would be complete without taking in the City Art Gallery. Sadly, Rossetti's famous pre-Raphaelite portrait of the young Queen Victoria as the goddess Aphrodite drinking from the fountain of Zeus is no longer on show. It was found to be a fake when cleaning revealed she was wearing a Leeds Rugby League Club jersey. A silly mistake, as Queen Victoria was, of course, a Hal Kingston Rovers supporter. Leeds galleries and museums may contain countless priceless artifacts, but keen-eyed visitors may also find here certain curiosities of no financial value, remnants from a bygone age guaranteed to kill half an hour. Let's meet the teams. They are, on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Paul Merton and Tim Brooke-Taylor. And keeping track of the scores and eager to get them down on the desk next to me, it's the delightful Samantha. We'll start with a round called Historical Headlines. Reporting the news in the olden days was a difficult business. In medieval times, they'd employ an old man to stand in the town square shouting at passers-by. And there's an interesting connection with our own Barry Cryer. Apparently, Barry's first ancestor would roam the streets of medieval England wearing a red coat with a funny hat and a little bell. In fact, if the family hadn't changed it, to this day, Barry would still bear the surname Noddy. Okay, teams, in this round I'd like you to imagine how today's newspapers and periodicals might have reported certain historical events. The event is King Arthur creates the Knights of the Round Table. Barry, will you start, please?
Daily Mail, King vetoes dome, orders round table.
Exchange and Mart, for sale, one square table, unused.
And from The Guardian, corrections and clarifications... Yesterday's headline, Arthur beds Guinevere, should have read Arthur weds ginger beer.
The Star, under the story of the 12th and last night circumference, had his awards stripped from him under the headline, Decorations to be taken down on 12th night.
There's one in the Express. Who gets a seat at round table? It's a lottery, says Camelot boss.
The Sport, Elvis seen in Camelot Sainsbury's.
The Daily Star, round table, Camelot knights ride back to MFI to collect missing wingnut.
Let's try another one of those. This time it's Robin Hood wins Nottingham archery contest. Tim.
The Lincoln Greenan. Robin Hood makes meal of victory in this year's Eton and Arrow match. This is a repeat.
Daily Mail, archer called Geoffrey to stand for sheriff.
In the, yes, the Robin Hood wins Nottingham archery contest was covered in the Yorkshire Post under the headline, Another Doublet and Hose Ban.
And in the Express, headline said, Tournament starts 15 minutes late. Outrage as archers move to 2 o'clock.
Nottingham Clarion, council install Little John in Forest.
And the Telegraph, Reverend Spooner arrested in Friar Tuck incident.
It's now time for the teams to sing. A signal for housebound music lovers everywhere to consult their copy of the Geneva Convention. The round is called Pick Up Song, where all that's required is a few discs and a gramophone to play them on. Samantha has specially selected some hit singles from her collection, and I noticed her 45s are already stacked up and ready to spin. Teams, you should sing along until at a random moment Samantha turns the volume down. Keep going all the while, and if when the music returns you're within a gnat's crotchet of the original record, I'll be awarding points. And points mean prizes. I'm not going to ask the audience what do points mean, because it always ends with mindless, idiotic shouting. All right, what do points mean? I think that proves my point. This week's prize will ideally suit the lover of Chinese food who needs to know exactly when it's cooked. It's this oven-ready speaking duck. We'll try a couple of duets again this week. Tim and Paul, would you please accompany Frank and Nancy Sinatra singing Something Stupid?
I know I stand in line until you think you have the time to spend an evening with me. And if we go someplace to dance, I know that there's a chance you won't be leaving with me. And afterwards we drop into a quiet little place and have a drink or two. And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like, I love you. I can see it in your eyes that you despise the same old lies that you heard the night before. And though it's just a line to you, for me it's true and never seemed so right before. I practice every day to find some clever lines to say to make the meaning come true.
Your turn, Barry and Graham. Please accompany Esther and Abby Oferim singing Cinderella Rockefeller.
You're the lady that I love.
I'm the lady who.
You're the lady that I love.
I'm the lady who.
You're the little lady.
I'm the little lady. Ooh, I love your touch.
Thank you so much. I love your eyes.
That's very nice.
I love your chin.
Say it again.
I love your chinny chin chin.
You're the fella that rocks me.
Rockefeller.
You're the fella that rocks me.
Rockefeller.
Points failure at Peterborough.
What do points mean?
Peterborough. Yeah.
We move on to an old favourite called Sound Charades. This is derived from the erstwhile television game Give Us a Clue, where the teams would act out plays, films or book titles within a strict time limit using only bodily mime. And what a fine entertainment it was. Fans, fans still speak in hushed tones of the day. Una Stubbs, her hands a blur, managed three men in a boat in less than 90 seconds. Our version of the game differs in one respect, in that the teams are allowed to use their tongues and lips to produce an effect known technically as speaking. Tim and Paul, you're to start. Your title will shortly be broadcast on the laser display screen. Well, here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
The Full Monty. The Full Monty.
Off you go, Paul and Tim, with your...
It's three words. It's a film. And we'll do it all together.
OK, here we go. Would you like some more, Field Marshal?
No, thanks. I've had quite enough.
Well, Field Marshal Slim, Field Marshal Haig.
Is it the full Rommel?
Very, very close.
The accent should give you a clue. Yeah.
The full Bronte.
No, it's very good. It was the full Monty.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Okay, your turn, Barry and Graham. Your title is now being exhibited on the laser display board. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Wall Street. Wall Street.
Go on, then.
And it's two words, and it's a film. Here it comes.
Himish. Ah, Dougal. Jings, Hamish, you're having your tea.
I am indeed. And, oh, this is lovely ice cream.
It looks at it, looks at it, looks... It looks a real treat. Who makes it?
Walls.
Any idea, Tim?
Not at all, no. Ice cream got a reaction.
Yes, it did.
Glass.
Ben and Jerry, Tom and Jerry.
Who made the ice cream?
Walls.
Walls. Something Wall. Is it in the title, Walls?
Walls is in the title, yeah.
The Walsall story.
And the ice cream was a real...
treat.
Treat.
Wall Street.
Time now for a game called What is the Question? This game is not to be confused with the amusing party game played by French philosophers entitled What is a Question? For those of you who've never been to a party with French philosophers, they are fun people. Very fond of party games. Favourites include I Spy, therefore I Am. Deconstruct the parcel. And of course, pin the tail on the externalised image of the long-eared quadruped. Okay, teams, now, I'll read out a series of answers and I'd like you please to suggest the original questions likely to have prompted them. Okay, Tim, here's the answer. What's the question? A royal flush.
What follows a royal we?
And, of course, the question should be, what beats a straight flush in poker? Graham, here's the answer again. What's the question? A creature halfway between a man and a horse.
What is a saddle?
Paul, now, your answer. Taking drugs and playing the violin.
Ah, yes. What are the two most effective forms of contraception?
The question should have been, how did Sherlock Holmes relax? Incidentally, I didn't tell you that the question on the previous one should have been, what is a centaur? But it's too late now and it doesn't matter. Who cares anyway? I don't. It's just... I thought it was a silly game to start with.
Oh. We're going out for a walk later. I haven't got your trousers. You've got them on.
OK, Barry. Barry, your answer is pensioners and buns.
You'll get him going.
Name two things you can often see in a post office. If you take some buns.
The real question is, what is Chelsea famous for? Okay, here are some for anyone to work out questions to who wishes. You get £200 each time.
That's what happens when you sell a roll of wallpaper to the Lord Chancellor.
Interestingly, the real question is, how much do you get for passing Go in Monopoly? Mm.
That is interesting.
He stuffs animals.
What does Rolf Harris do when the cameras aren't on him?
How about this one? It always comes back.
What happens when you thought you'd seen the last episode of The Last of the Summer Wine?
Or, it always comes back. What's the worst thing about being ill out of a train window?
This one has some connection, I think. They both change colour.
Well, what do Judith Chalmers and Michael Jackson have in common?
The real answer, or the real question, rather, is what connects chameleons and traffic lights? Right, it's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First of all, I noticed there's a splendid card on the mantelpiece to mark the official reopening of Mornington Crescent Tube and sent to us by a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. Mrs. Trellis has taken the trouble to find the appropriate Gordon Fraser special occasion card. On the front it says, Happy Northern Line Underground Station Reopening, above a picture of a vintage car with a set of golf clubs in it. Right, well, as we're in Yorkshire this week, it's only natural we should play the Northern League version of Mornington Crescent, a fluent form of play made popular by the monks of Kirkstall Abbey. There are several obvious variations from the standard game. Cloistering is only allowed after Kensal Rise has been played. A slow player may be declared Trappist by the player to his left, resulting in the handicap of remaining silent for two moves while writing his instructions to his partner to play. OK, Tim, will you start, please?
Cheapside.
Ooh. You're right. Church. Kirkgate. Kirkgate.
I'm going to avoid the cloister.
Yeah.
Kirkgate, one word. That's one word, is it? Kirkgate?
Yeah.
One word.
I can feel Headingley coming on.
Shall I open a window?
I feel it definitely had a Trappist coming on if it didn't move on.
Rose Terrace.
Rose?
Rose Terrace.
Piccadilly Circus.
Collier's Wood.
Duke Street.
Mordenhall Road.
It's cloistering, isn't it?
No, it's okay.
Kensal Rise.
Yeah.
Kensal Rise.
Yes, it was. Mm. Platts Lane.
Who said Kensal Rise anyway?
I didn't move my lips.
But did you say it?
No. Larry, did you say Kensal Rise?
I did not, Humph.
No, he didn't.
Somebody must have said Kensal Rise. Who said Are you hearing the voices again? They're friendly.
Who said cloistering, then?
I said cloistering.
But it wasn't your turn.
Well, in effect, it was.
Was it?
Yep.
Well, what did Paul say?
Matron says he's like this every night.
Well, if, with a bit of luck, somebody might be recording this so we can play it back and find out.
Yes. Yep.
What I mean is he didn't say Kensal Rise, did he?
No, I didn't say Kensal Rise.
Well, then it can't be cloistering.
It must have been me.
No, I said cloistering and he said Kensal Rise.
Yeah, but that's the wrong way round. It says here, after Kensal Rise has been played.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, he said cancel rice after you said cloistering.
How do you know?
Just admitted it.
How do you know?
Just admitted it.
I had black hair when we started.
I mean, if we're going to play this game, let's play it right. Anyway, before I'm accused of being Trappist...
Well, half of it's true.
Carry on, Paul.
Go. Tottenham Court Road.
Good. Street Lane.
Apart from the fact it wasn't your turn...
I've been cloistered.
No, it was after a cloister. I could go then. Mm.
But no... Listen, nobody said Kensal Rise.
In that case...
Don't make up the rules as you go along. Paul. Paul.
Well, it seems to me I'm the only one that's saying anything. Old Street.
Yes, I know. Camden Town. Yeah.
Barkingside.
Mornington Crescent.
Yeah!
No. Right into it.
Right, it's time now for the teams to exercise a little discretion. I've noticed recently there's far too much smut and filth polluting our airwaves. Ever since I worked out how to program my new video recorder, in fact. But it's not only TV that suffers with truly offensive material. Songs can also be afflicted, teams, and with this in mind, I'd like you please to sing certain medleys, but taking care to buzz out any words that might cause offence to listeners or of a delicate disposition. Do bear in mind, teams, that excessive use of the buzzer may drown out the piano accompaniment of Colin Sell. If that doesn't work, you might try banging a shoe on the desk. Okay, teams, I'd like you each to censor the work of a certain popular artiste. You're to start, Barry and Graham, and your artiste is Tom Jones. Off you go, please.
It's not unusual to be by anyone. It's not unusual to have with anyone. But when I see you about with anyone, it's not unusual to see me. I wanna the old hometown looks the same as I step down from the train. And there to meet me is my mama and my papa. Down the road I look and there runs Mary, hair of gold and like cherries. It's good to touch the of home.
Okay, your turn, Tim and Paul. Would you please provide a censored medley from the songbook of Elvis Presley?
You ain't nothing but a hound dog all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog all the time. Well, you ain't never a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine.
Can't you see I you? Please don't break my in two. It's not hard to do, 'cause I don't have a word. It's now or never. Come hold me tight. Kiss me, my darling. Be mine tonight. Tomorrow will be too late. It's now or never. My won't wait.
Well, the end of the show is fast approaching. But not before the teams announce the late arrivals at the overweight ball. Samantha says she likes to keep in trim lifting weights. So while she nips out to her new gym to enjoy a good half hour's pumping, I'd like the teams to announce the names of the guests arriving at a ball for the overweight. Graham, will you start, please?
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Normus and their son, Yuri.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. at the size of him, their son, Luke, at the size of him.
Oh, and just behind them, a special diet version of our pianist, Colin Cellulite.
Oh, there's Terry Waite. With his Swedish cousin, Ova. And his friend, Lars of the Summer Pudding.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Pound of Belgian Chocolates Won't Do Any Harm, Surely. And their hermaphrodite child, Shirley Arthur Pound of Belgian Chocolates.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Feltz and their good grief.
And they've brought their parrot polyunsaturated.
It's cabaret time.
Oh, not before time.
We've got Tummy Steele, George Belly, Flabby Sifra. Compare Lloyd Grossman. At the top of the bill is Fats Domino singing Blubbery Hill.
Closely followed by the Suction Brothers. Groucho, Harpo, Chico and Lippo.
Mr. and Mrs. to supper room just by moving away from the window. And their son Eli supper room just by moving away. Who's that over there in the corner? It's Gorge Michael. Quietly masticating. Now.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as the armpit hair of time is snagged in the ball deodorant of destiny, and the harpic of eternity spills unseen onto the loo roll of fate, I notice it's the end of the show. So from the team, Samantha, myself, and the good people of Leeds, goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden and Paul Merton were be given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us today in Southsea, the fine Hampshire coast town where visitors with an interest in history seek out the many exhibitions and museums to see how a simple island race lived in the distant past. Alternatively, they can hop on a ferry to the Isle of Wight. The town serves as the residential district of Portsmouth. Although a small naval base since Roman times, the port really grew when Henry VII had his dry dock built here. He hadn't intended it to be a dry dock. That only came about after the running of it past the Southern Water PLC. Most famously, the port is associated with Lord Nelson's flagship, the Victory, to which visitors flock to see the very spot where the great man fell. It's marked by a plaque reading, "Here on July the 12th, 1798, Lord Nelson tripped over a bloke screwing a brass plate to the deck after inadvertently putting his patch on the wrong eye." Let's meet the teams. On my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Sandy Toksvig and Tim Brooke Taylor. Now, I'm afraid our regular scorer, Samantha, can't be with us today. She was advised to have a couple of days in bed by her new GP after discovering a different practice. She reckons a day or two under the doctor should sort her out. So please welcome in her stead our Swedish stand-in, Sven. Okay, on with the first game, teams, which is all about cutting costs. It's called Cost Cutters. There's nothing that gets my goat more than the senseless waste of license fee income, which is why I've instructed the BBC to stop putting chilled champagne in my dressing room. There's no point going to the expense of chilling it if it's only going in the bath. So with economy very much the watchword, teams, I'd like you please to suggest some cost-cutter versions of films, TV or radio shows that might be made within a strict budget. Barry, would you like to start?
Conan the Librarian.
Sandy.
The English Outpatient.
Graham.
10% discount off the bill.
And Tim?
Alistair Cook's email from America.
To the semi-born.
Clive Anderson talks less.
Oh. In your dreams.
Mission perfectly feasible. The great Grimsby.
Raiders of the Lost Ark Lamp with Harrison Skoda.
The National Lottery Big Ticket has become... No, sorry, that couldn't be cheaper than it already is.
Gunfight at the less than satisfactory corral.
Mastermind with Peter Snow.
Samson and the Lilo.
Those magnificent men with their sewing machines.
I'd quite like to see that.
Our next game has the title One Song to the Tune of Another. This is a cunning musical game that cleverly combines the music of one song with the words of another, such that the teams appear, as if by magic, to be singing two songs at the same time. The game originated on the occasion that Ireland first won the Eurovision Song Contest. At the celebration party, Ireland's lovely entrant, Dana, got carried away, jumped on stage, and delighted revellers by doing all kinds of everything with Paddy McGinty's goat. And providing musical accompaniment, we have the master of unusual combinations. You haven't seen them, I did, in the dressing room. At the piano, Colin Sell. Barry, I'd like you to start, please, by singing the words to Don't Dilly Dally on the Way to the tune of Can't Help Falling in Love.
My old man said follow the van and don't dilly dally on the way. Off went the cart with a home packed in it, and I walked behind with my old cock limit. But I dilly-dallied, dallied, and I dillied, lost the van and don't know where.
stopped on the way to have the old half quartern and I can't find my way home.
Okay, your turn, Sandy. Will you please sing the words of Animal Crackers in My Soup to the tune of the Toreador's March?
Animal crackers in my soup. Monkeys and rabbits loop the loop. Gosh, oh gee, but I have fun swallowing animals one by one. In every bowl of soup I see lions and tigers. What do you mean? When I get hold of the bad wolf, I just push him under to drown. Then I bite him in a million bits, and I gobble him right down.
You may have noticed Colin Sell couldn't keep in time with the audience. Okay, it's you now, Graham. Would you please sing the words of Don't Blame It on the Boogie to the tune of the Battle Hymn of the Republic?
My baby's always dancing. It wouldn't be a bad thing. But I don't get no loving, and that's no lie. We spent the night in Frisco at every kind of disco, and from that night I kissed our love goodbye. Don't blame it on the sunshine. Don't blame it on the moonlight. Don't blame it on the good times. Blame it on the boogie. That nasty boogie bugs me, but somehow it had drugged me. That spellbound rhythm gets me all night through. I've changed my way of living. I've filled my pipe and lit it. My baby just can't take her eyes off me altogether.
Finally, Tim, would you please sing the words of Run, Rabbit, Run to the tune of Delilah?
Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, 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 rabbit, run. Rabbit, run, run, bang, 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 goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run. Rabbit, run, 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 rabbit, run, run. Don't give the farmer his fun, fun, fun. He'll get by without his rabbit pie. So rabbit, run, run, run. Oh, rabbit, run, 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 rabbit, run.
Well, it's time now to play a round called Word for Word. In this round, I'd like one team to start by exchanging a series of random and completely unconnected words. The opposing team should challenge if they detect a connection. If I uphold the challenger should take over and so on. Okay, would you start, please? Tim and Sandy.
Cauliflower.
Smattering.
Bucket.
Challenge from Graham.
Yeah, Tim had a smattering of cauliflower for lunch. I saw him.
I wasn't there.
How do you know?
I was there.
Oh, it was you. Overruled. Turnip.
Twaddle.
Coxcomb.
Fledgling.
Chorister.
Slime.
Corpulence.
Corpulent slime. Yugoslavia's Eurovision entry. 1958. Should have won, in my opinion.
No, I won't accept that one.
Quite right, too, if I may
say. Well, it was 1957.
Windsock.
Comb.
Gogglebox.
Tupperware.
Challenge from Graham.
I have a Tupperware goggle box at home.
Is it frightfully useful, Graham?
I keep my goggles in it.
Ah, well. Do they stay fresh?
They stay fresh.
It's worth every penny, then, Graham.
Yes, fresh and crisp.
Okay, Graham, that was a good challenge.
Was it? Right.
Right.
Rabbit. Run.
Sandy.
What?
Sandy, you challenge.
Those are the words to a famous Tom Jones song. I don't know what...
Go on.
Burrow. Mulch. Cauliflower. Broccoli. Smattering. Slime. Corpulent.
Okay, it's time now for a splendid round called Complete Quotes. It's surprising how many of us don't know the complete version of many famous quotations. For example, there are those immortal words of Neville Chamberlain, "I have in my hand a piece of paper." Would someone pass a new roll under the door, please? In this round, teams, you'll hear a series of well-known personalities speaking, each of whom has unfortunately stopped in mid-sentence. I'd like you to finish them off, please. That's the quotations. Barry, we'll start with you. Will you finish off these words of Anne Widdecombe?
For me personally, and it is only a personal statement, this is just the last straw in a very large bale of straws. I do not see that it's now possible to...
take part in your wet T-shirt competition.
Okay, it's you now, Sandy. Here's the Duchess of York.
Actually, a gentleman sat next door to me once. I said, you know, Prince Albert was a great, great dad. He really was. And this man said,
shh, we're at a funeral.
Strictly speaking, I shouldn't be doing that to your toe either.
Tim, Prince Edward for you.
I've been promoted, I think, from when I was just a general dog's body, and this time, unfortunately, I'm going to be
a field marshal dog's body.
Okay, Graham, some words of Peter Mandelson being interviewed by James Naughtie.
I've got a big smile on my face, but as you know, I'm a very cautious fellow.
Oh, yes, of course you are, but do you think it's a big one?
I think it is likely to be a substantial one, and it is going to be
a tribute to Viagra.
Okay, well, we'll open this up now. Here are some for any of you to finish off. Some words of Prince Charles first.
I'm not very good at being a performing monkey, really. I'm not prepared to just...
let Camilla grind my organ. Oh, all hopes of ever being honoured dashed.
This time is Saddam Hussein's official spokesman.
For it is a right on all of us to carry out the holy jihad, the holy war of Islam, to liberate the holy
Holy shit, he's got a gun.
Okay, yes, Prince Philip.
I know that I can speak for the Worldwide Fund for Nature and probably for the whole conservation movement in welcoming
the first grouse of the year.
And finally, John Redwood.
I'm talking about schoolgirls, 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds, maybe 16-year-olds. I'm not just talking about the money. One of the problems, if you invite young women into flats before they've got any qualifications and are not properly equipped for the adult world, is...
If you want to hear more, call 0890...
Right, we're going to try an interesting game now. We're going to play a game we call Cheddar Gorge. We call it that in honour of the fact that all the regulars on the programme are big cheese fans. Graham is a member of the Roquefort Appreciation Society. Tim receives the Parmesan newsletter. And Barry has a regular subscription to a Danish Blue magazine. In this round, I'll be asking the teams to construct a sentence by each of them uttering a single word at a time. The object is not to complete a sentence. Regular listeners will be pleased to hear I've still got the horn. And when I decide a sentence has been completed, I'll make a noise on it like this. Okay, teams, I'd like your sentences to take the form of a wreath lecture on the subject of the Spice Girls. Graham, will you start, please?
I'll
tell
you
what
I want to
do
this
evening
when
the
Spice
Girls
come
over
in
the
scariest possible
and posh
girls
don't
like
to
eat
anything
to
aggravate
because
it
somehow
tends
to
annoy
some
baby
spices
such
as
Mel,
who
is
the
best
of
all
the
younger
Mel's
around
the
outskirts
of
this
very
pleasant
little
fair
and
amenable
seaside
and
yet
inland
revenue
officer, I will
never
come
with
any
more
of
this
ridiculous
nonsense.
Okay, well, it's time for a musical round now called Dysfunctional Duets. In this round, teams, I'd like you to sing duets in the style of unlikely partnerships. The history of popular music is littered with strange pairings, as indeed was this stage earlier after Barry Cryer's novelty act of clipping his toenails to the tune of the Trumpet Voluntary. As ever, Colin Sell will be providing backup on the piano, although that's by no means his only instrument. In fact, I have a cutting here from Jazz Monthly magazine written by their top reviewer. It reads, "When I heard Colin Sell playing the mouth organ, I rushed in just in time to catch his set. He really should use a stronger denture fix if he wants to, if he wants to blow that hard." You're to start, Tim and Sandy. Would you please sing Puff the Magic Dragon in the style of that well-known partnership, Peter, Paul and Mary Whitehouse?
Be
Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea.
Wait a minute, are there people with dragon in this?
Let in the autumn mist in a land called Annalise.
Oh no, I don't think you can have that. That's rhyming slang for something disgusting, isn't it?
Little Jackie Paper.
Oh no, there's children involved now.
Love that rascal Puff.
Oh!
And brought in strings and sealing wax.
Oh, I knew it.
And other fancy stuff.
No, don't tell me there's going to be thongs and rubberware and, oh, strap-on things.
Together they would travel on boat with billowed sails.
Well, what does that mean? I know it's something revolting.
Jackie kept a lookout, perched on Puff's gigantic tail.
They're on top of each other now.
Noble kings and princes.
Defend that.
Well, there are no queens anyway. Would bow whene'er they came. Pirate ships would lower their flag when Puff roared out his name.
Oh, I've never heard anything so disgusting. You listen and you'll hear. Oh, Puff the magic dragon.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Frolicking the autumn mist in a land called Honolulu.
Okay, it's your turn, Barry and Graham. Would you please sing Wandering Star as Lee Marvin and his hairdresser?
I was born under a wandering star.
No! I was born under a wandering star. Bouncing.
Wheels are made for rolling.
Mules are made to pack. Always pop a pair in my suitcase.
I've never seen a sight that didn't look better looking
better look
back.
Looking I know, back. Yes.
I was born under a wandering star.
I know, you said.
Mud can make you prisoner.
And the plains can bake you dry.
I know. Snow can burn your eyes.
But I tell you, only people make you cry.
So true. Home is made for coming from.
Well, and for dreams of going to as well. Don't forget that.
Which, with any luck, will never come true.
No, never. A little more off the bottom.
Easy round the edges. I was born.
Yes, I know.
Under a wandering star.
Yes, you can say that again.
A wandering.
A wandering.
Wandering
star. Yes.
Star.
Well, I've enjoyed our little chat. Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there's just time to squeeze in a round of Airline Pilots Songbook.
Sven was telling us he has an exhausting job working nights driving those nice air stewards to and from the airport. His shift includes various routes, but he doesn't get off until he's been to Heathrow and Felton. So while he nips off, I'll ask the teams to suggest some popular songs to suit an audience of pilots and other airline staff. Anybody can start this one.
Airline coffee, airline tea. I like that.
Boeing Crosby sings 747. Qantas Amera.
could have an anthem for economy charters. Ooey, cheapy, cheapy seat seats.
You put your Lufthansa in.
Alitalia, what you fancy, the ziggurat?
The Pink Panther theme, of course. Pan Am, Pan Am, Pan Am, Pan Am.
Beethoven's Ode to Joystick.
Stansted by your man.
And Kate Bush with her big hit, Heathrow, It's Me, It's Cathay Pacific.
Like a virgin? No thanks, I've just put one out.
Sabina, Hard Day's Night.
The L Alley Uya Chorus.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the Robin Cook of time wheedles out of the public inquiry of destiny, and the Michael Howard of eternity chokes on his own smug smile of fate, I notice it's the end of the show. So from Sven, the teams, myself, and the fine folk of South Sea, it's goodbye.
Carr, Graham Garden, Sandy Toksvig and Tim Brooke Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel gaze. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello, hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that's never afraid to grab the bull by the horn. You join us... You join us for a second week at the King's Theatre in Southsea for what is the last programme in the current series. And there isn't a single word in our language that can express how we all feel at this news. It takes a minimum of four. Absolutely delighted and thoroughly relieved. Southsea and neighbouring Portsmouth share links with many famous historical figures. Isambard Kingdom Brunel was born here and christened in the local church amid great celebration, as his parents had just won the first two prizes in Southsea's most stupid novelty name for a small child competition. Now, after our panel appeared here last week and promised a second show, a throng of locals besieged the theatre, queuing overnight for returns. But the manager refused point blank to take any tickets back, so the teams do actually have an audience. And here are the teams. On my right, Sandy Toksvig and Tim Brooke Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And please welcome our stand-in scorer all the way from Sweden, the very rippling Sven. Sven was telling us how pleased he is to be here again, as his shows go much better in Portsmouth than in London. He always enjoys impressive ratings down here. Right, on with the games, which this week begin with a round of historical headlines. Teams, I'd like you please to suggest how today's publications might have reported certain historical events. And the first is Nelson's victory at Trafalgar. Would you like to start, please, Graham?
Yes, a headline from The Times. Nelson's column gets go-ahead. But what's going to be inside it? Uh,
Oh, I have a copy of The Guardian here. Yesterday's headline should have read, Admiral shot on deck.
The Daily Star, readers save donkey in Spain.
Wrestling Times, half Nelson invented.
Grecian Column Makers Monthly.
I take it regularly.
New work likely.
And also in The Guardian on their corrections and clarifications page, yesterday's headline, French Navi loses battle. should have read, French Navy loves bottle.
Daily Telegraph, Nelson denies selling arm to Sierra Leone.
Let's try another one. This time it's Richard III crowned king after princes murdered in Tower. Tim.
The Sun, dickhead crowned.
Exchange and marks. King swaps kingdom for horse.
The Express, Prince's murders. Police are following a hunch.
Conservative Party newsletter, August 1483. Class sizes reduced in Royal Primary School.
What have I here? The arts page of The Guardian. King announces winner of disco tent. The Sun, 10 things you never knew about Richard III. One, he uses a wok to iron his shirts.
And there's one in the Gloucester Echo, local man gets top job.
The Daily Star, readers save donkey in Spain.
The Independent, Richard III, crowned king.
And in The Guardian's corrections and clarifications column, yesterday's headline, Ponce's throne in Tower. Should have read, Prince's throw in towel.
Perusing this card in front of me, I see we have a singing round now called Pick Up Song, where the teams join in with discs from my collection. DJ Sven has spent all afternoon in the singles section of my record library, where he's pulled out every one of the Village People's 7 inches.
Dear feedback.
After thinking about them long and hard, it is like... he decided they didn't suit and made another selection for the teams. As your allocated disc plays, teams, each of you should sing along. At my signal, Sven will turn the volume down as you attempt to stay in time. If on its return you're within a nits cheesy quaver of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. Or points means the third person singular case of the verb to point. What do points... what does points mean? This week's prize is a tasty snack from the new Sarson's Chiropody range. It's this jar of pickled bunions. We'll try two duets this week. Barry and Graham, would you please accompany Stan Laurel and Oliver Hardy singing The Trail of the Lonesome Pine?
Mountains of Virginia, on the trail of the lonesome pine, in the pale moonshine, our hearts entwine, where she carved her name, and I carved mine own tune. Does the mountains are blue like the pine, I am lonesome for you. In the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia, on the trail of the lonesome pine. In the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia, on the trail of the lonesome pine. In the pale moonshine, our hearts entwine.
Okay, you now, Tim and Sandy, and I'd like you to accompany the singing nuns with their delightful number, with their delightful number, Dominique.
Dominique, Nique, Nique, sur la laisse de mon routier, au vrai chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il me parle de bon Dieu, il me parle complètement. À la paix qu'on joue son terre, terre est très lourde. Dominique, notre père, en baptise et leur besoin. Dominique, Nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne part que de bon Dieu. Il ne part que de bon Dieu. C'est un jour un hérétique, avec le temps du conduit, mais notre père Dominique, par ce joie, l'a converti. Dominique, Dominique, s'en allait tout simplement, routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne part que de mon Dieu, il ne part que
l'amour, ni diligence.
Right, let's hurry along. Charades is a popular, amusing and thoroughly entertaining parlour game requiring skill, imagination and a keen sense of fun. It therefore has no place in this programme. So instead we're going to play a subtle variation called Sound Charades, in which contestants provide clues to certain titles using only their mouths. It's not, of course, to be confused with the French version, Charade d'Epardieu, in which contestants provide clues using only their noses. Tim and Sandy, you're to start. Your title will now be broadcast on the in-house virtual reality laser display screen. And for listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
The Horse Whisperer. The Horse Whisperer.
Barry and Graham, you're guessing this one. Okay, off you go, Tim and Sandy.
It's three words, it's a book, and it's a new film. Bring, bring.
Hello.
Here. Would you like the winner of the 2:30 at Pontefract?
I'm sorry?
Would you like a winner of the 2:30 at Pontefract?
Well, that's awfully kind of you, but I honestly don't think my garden's big enough.
Fair enough. All right.
Go ahead, Barry and Graham.
Three words, book and a film. A lot of whispering going on. Sound of a little horse.
Yes.
It does the warm, word.
Warm.
Does the word the appear?
Yes, the horse mutterer.
The horse whisperer.
Yay!
Right, your turn, Barry and Graham. Your title is now being exhibited on the laser display board, and here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Deconstructing Harry. Deconstructing Harry.
Okay, Barry and Graham, do your mime, please.
This is a film.
A film, and it's two words.
Two words.
Ah, Hamish.
Dougal. You'll have had your tea.
Aye, I have indeed. What are you doing up that ladder?
Oh, it's a sad day. I'm taking down this sign you see outside Harry's House of Haggis.
Oh, could I give you a hand?
No, not just now, Dougal. I'm busy.
No. Let me help.
Oh, very kind. That's very kind of you. Well, help me down with this H.
Oh,
there we go.
What's next?
A.
I said, what's next?
No, Dougal. The letter A. Letter A.
There we go. Hamish, are you going to be all right with your R's up there?
Don't you worry, I'll soon get them down. Why?
Why what?
Why bother? Well, that's it done.
You've done the job, Hamish, sure enough.
Aye.
Oh.
Okay, start guessing Tim and Sandy.
The longest day. Letters, is that...
Spelled out Harry for some reason. Harry.
That won't help.
Harry's ladder.
Would it be dirty in any way?
No.
Breaking Harry. Is it destructing?
Destroying Harry.
Deconstructing Harry.
And with the game finally poised...
I like that second.
We go on for an educational round called What's the Question? In this round, the teams will be playing a reverse form of general knowledge where I provide an answer and they guess what the question might have been. So, for example, if the answer is because it was there, the question was obviously, why did Barry Cryer go to the pub? Okay, teams, here are some answers, but what are the questions? Starting with you, Barry. Hanging in the bathroom.
What is too good for people who pee in the bath?
Real answer is, where did Francis I of France keep the Mona Lisa when he originally bought it in 1517?
Or where would you find George Michael?
Graham, here you are. 90% of it is done by females.
What do men like about housework?
How does a pride of... This is your answer, which is the question.
What?
How does a pride of lions share out the hunting responsibilities? Tim, not if your name is Mary.
Is Christmas a good name?
Well, the real answer is it legal to be a prostitute in Siena? Sandy, they have both sets of sexual organs on their bodies.
What singles out a successful Eurovision Song Contest winner?
The real answer is, how can you tell that worms are hermaphrodite? Okay, here are some that any of you can answer. 700 wives.
Who can do the work of 4 million men?
Right on, sister. Dominique Nicken.
The real question should be, how many wives did King Solomon have? They weren't allowed to touch his face.
What were Robin Cook's plastic surgeons not allowed to do?
Well, I don't know who's been reading what book of statistics, but the answer is, what part of Emperor Napoleon's body were prostitutes forbidden to touch?
Except in those Seattle. Called Mary.
Here's the last one. Here's the last answer. Saltpeter.
Jesus, what do you want on your last supper?
The answer is, what is added to charcoal and sulphur to make gunpowder? Right, it's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First of all, I noticed from the duty log that we've received a letter of complaint from an irate listener, a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes, Dear Kenton, I was appalled on tuning in this morning to hear a torrent of blatant filth with terms such as Big Bang, large firm success, satisfying performance, and worst of all, job blows. It was the most disgusting edition of the Today programme Business Report ever. Yours faithfully, Mrs. Trellis, Wild Shag Cottage, Upper Sheepshead. Upper Sheepsbottom Lane, much humping on sea. Okay, teams, on with the game. And since we're on the South Coast, we'll play a nautical version, developed in England by French sailors captured during the Napoleonic Wars, which they knew as Mornington Croissant. According to the Martello Convention, thank you very much indeed. According to the Martello Convention of 1807, the broadside turn, whereby a player can repeat his opponent's declaration and thereby reverse the order of play, though usually frowned upon by the standard game, is positively encouraged here. Otherwise, sudden diagonal play to starboard is referred to as tacking, and once a player is blocked, they're in poop. And should miss a turn. Tim, will you start, please?
Neasden.
Gerrard Street.
Wapping.
No, I was just trying an offside. I know a broadside turn there.
You could.
No, I can stop it with Covent Garden.
Yeah.
But that's the matter. The Matelot Convention, isn't it?
Yeah. Does that mean he's in poop?
No. Well, no. That's no. Beside the point. No. It's reversed then, isn't it?
Oh, yes. Because you've got a diagonal.
So if I say Victoria, it comes through. Victoria.
Victoria.
Straightforward.
Repeat. Reverse.
Hounslow Central. Comes back.
Right,
yeah. Goes back round now, doesn't it?
Yeah. Lancaster Gate.
Oh, well, I could do a double play now. Totteridge and Whetstone.
Brilliant.
So that restores the order.
Yeah.
Yep, go on.
Runcorn Avenue.
No.
Shooter's Hill.
Too late, he said it now.
Oh, you see, he would have been in poop if you hadn't jumped in.
Too late.
Didn't you worry?
He jumped in. He missed the poop.
Queensgate. Oh,
Could have got it then.
I know.
We're backtracking it. All right, we're backtracking it.
You haven't played it very often, don't you?
No, I know, I didn't know I could go straight to Mornington.
Yeah.
Oh, no, now? No. Tack, is this tacking? I don't know. No. Ebury Street.
Mornington Crescent. Oh.
Well, it's time now for a round called Madrigal. A madrigal, of course, was a kind of medieval lament, bemoaning the state of the world and harking back to a mythical golden age which never existed. In the modern world, of course, this is known as the Daily Mail. In this round, the teams will take it in turns to sing various lines in order to make up the verses of a madrigal. As usual, musical accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell, who I hear caused panic on the stock market recently simply by shouting his name 3 times down the telephone. It's Colin. Okay, I'll provide you with a subject, teams, about which I'd like you to compose a madrigal, taking one line each until you hear this noise. The subject is the Eurovision Song Contest. Tim, will you start, please?
As I switched on my TV set in the merry month of May,
Terry Wogan was twittering in his inimitable way.
A blimp was singing in a frock.
It didn't seem quite kosher. So I returned to reading
my new Nova Scotia brochure.
But when the song was over, it seemed to be irrational.
The bloke who had been singing was called Dana International. He'd had an operation,
and my, how high he sang.
And now he's got to number one,
although he's got null point.
Well, that's nearly all we have time for, but we must just squeeze in the football manager's ball. So while Sven nips out to run a finger down his fantasy 11, and imagines who he might have to pull off at half-time, I'll ask the teams to announce the late arrivals at a ball for football managers. Okay, Barry.
Will you welcome Mr. and Mrs. Dickris signing in? And their son, Ludicrous, signing in.
Will you please welcome Mr. and Mrs. the Bastard in the Black? And their son, Hughes, the Bastard in the Black.
And from Scotland, will you welcome Mr. and Mrs. Anne and their son, Bernie? Hi, Bernie Anne. Motherwell.
Just behind them, Mr. and Mrs. Nahum Hotspur and their baby, Tot.
Oh, these two are fun. Mr. and Mrs. Time Bollockin and their son, Arthur Time Bollockin.
And a warm, warm welcome, please, for Mr. and Mrs. Bennett Ref. Get your bleed nice tested. And their son, Gordon Bennett, Rev, get a very nice testy.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Palace Mill, Derby County 5. And their daughter, Crystal Palace Mill.
Mr. and Mrs. Game of Two Halves, and their daughter, Itza.
There's Kenny Dalglish over there making the Mafia an offer they can't understand.
Mr. and Mrs. Drool. And their decidedly dodgy son, Offside Drool.
Will you please welcome from Germany, Herr and Frau Over the Ghoulies when you're standing in the wall. And their son, Hans Over the Ghoulies.
And so... Oh,
look, there's Glenn Hoddle and Chris Waddle with a model. What a doddle.
Mr. and Mrs. Academicals Mill. And their son, Hamilton.
Mr. and Mrs. Throvers and their son, Ray Throvers.
And will you welcome from Scotland from the old days, Mr. and Mrs. Champions and their diminutive son, the Wee Arthur Champion. Welcome back. Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. The Ball, your great fairy, and their son, Ed the Ball, your great... So,
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the flatulent skunk of time wanders into the air conditioning system of eternity, and the piranha fish of fate circles hungrily in the bidet of destiny, I notice it's the end of the show, and indeed the series. We'll be back again. Well, we'll be back again in the autumn. In the meantime, for myself, Sven, the teams, and the sunny people of Southsea, it's goodbye.
Barry Pryor, Graham Garden, Sandy Toksvig, and Timbrook Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sells setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson, and the producer was John Naismith.